companies that repeatedly borrow money in the convertible bond market file bankruptcy at some point. So it's kind of what we call the last saloon. Hi, my name's Larry McDonald. I'm the founder and the creator of the Bear Traps Report. I started off over the years in convertible bonds. I was fortunate enough to create the first website in the world that organically organized the convertible bond universe. We sold it to Morgan Stanley in the late 90s, thank God. And then from there, I became a trader. I ran one of our more profitable distressed businesses at Lehman Brothers. And I was the most profitable trader in our group there for a number of years, trading distressed debt and convertible debt and capital structure arbitrage. From there, as Lehman was buckling, Lehman was a big bank that blew up in 2008. I wrote a New York Times bestseller about the failure of Lehman Brothers. It's been published in 12 languages now. It's a New York Times bestseller. It's one of the best-selling business books on the planet Earth, thank God. And I tell my wife once a month, if we sell 1 million books, we'll break even on our Lehman stock. So, over the years, we've developed our 21 Lehman systemic risk indicators, which is pretty helpful around macro turns in the market. And they measure a number of different things. And then we have our company-specific risk indicators. And so we can kind of take a look at, I think, maybe on the company side first. But at the end of the day, when you're looking at companies, the capital structure is very important, because one of the big warning signs that I've learned over the years is if you look at companies, multiple issuers in the convertible bond market, there's been dozens of bankruptcies of companies, Adelphia Communications, Calpine, Tyco. I mean, we can go on and on and on, but companies that repeatedly borrow money in the convertible bond market, like a very high percentage of the time, file bankruptcy at some point. Chesapeake is the most recent one. There are multiple convertible issuer. So it's kind of what we call the last saloon. When a CFO approaches a bank to borrow money, the way they do that is very telling, and they can borrow in the fixed income market, and they can borrow in the equity market, or they can borrow in converts. I mean, there's a lot of different ways to borrow money. Go to a bank and get a bank loan. But oftentimes, the convertible bond market, especially a serial issuer, it's the last saloon. It's a very place where companies that have either been priced out of the high yield market or priced out of bank loans, they really have to sell convertible debt, which allows investors to short their stock. So convertible arbitrage, those type of hedge funds, they're willing to buy those bonds at par or at 100. And what they'll do is they'll short the stock at the same time. So they're hedged. So a company can sell bonds, borrow money from a group of people that are actually fairly skeptical in many cases. And I think it's one of our first leading warning indicators is the serial convertible bond issuer. If you're looking for warning signs on stocks not to short and maybe to get long, is companies that have had a near-term problem with debt maturities, and because of the Fed and the credit cycle, they've been able to extend those maturities out. So if you think of the commodity cycle historically, these companies typically are very levered. And there's a number of companies now that I would not short just because Arch Coal, BTU, Peabody, these companies have typically over the years had a rolling problem where their debt maturities were constantly rolling. And many times you see companies that have near-term debt maturities that are very substantial relative to the equity market cap. So you've got the stock. You think of a pie, right? You've got the stock, and that's a component of the pie, and you have the debt. And if 50% of the debt is maturing within 2 to 3 years, and that is a good chunk of your, what the pie is what's called enterprise value. So you've got your equity market cap and your debt, and that together plus cash is your enterprise value. If your near-term debt maturities are daunting, and if they're, say 1-2 years out, you've got a little size, those are the stocks you want to short. If it's a smaller cap stock, it's a cheap stock, it's a low price, and they've been able to extend those debt maturities, what they essentially have done is they've turned their equity into a long-term call option or a warrant. because the equity, the knockout punch that's typically there in a credit cycle, as many people know, you go through credit cycles. And when I grew up in the business, every 2-3 years, the credit markets would shut down. That doesn't happen anymore because of the central banks. But in a normal business cycle, there's a cleansing process, and capital markets typically would shut down, and then levered companies that were not properly structured would be great short candidates. And so one thing I'd be wary of is over the last year, especially in commodities, you've had a lot of companies that, you think about commodities the last 10 years, it's 2016, a really bad bear market in commodities, and then we had a really bad bear market in 2018, 19, 20. So a lot of these companies have cleaned up their balance sheets, have extended those maturities, and so in some respects, there's a tremendous long opportunity in some of these commodity stocks relative to other sectors. But that's what you want to look at, is look at the capital structure and look for opportunities both on the long side and the short side. Yeah, so then there's just like how the credit's performing, you know, how the bonds are performing versus the stock, and that, you know, so which kind of gets into like default risk. But what drives me crazy is when you meet younger people in the market that might be long a stock. Say a company's worth $400 billion of enterprise value, to keep it simple, but $300 billion of that is in debt, and $100 billion in equity. That's a situation where if you're an equity investor and you're like a younger investor and you're like investing in the stock and you're not looking at the bonds every day, you're setting yourself up for a big, big problem. You want to be looking at the capital structure. You want to be looking at and how those bonds are trading. And if those bonds are underperforming, if you see like, you know, say a 1 or 2 week period where the stock's up, say in a 10-day period, the stock's up over 10 trading days, the stock's up 6 or 7 times, but the bonds are down, you know, 50% of the time, look out, you're gonna get hurt. Because once again, the company's worth $400 billion of enterprise value, but $300 billion of that's in the bonds. The equity is just a little sliver, right? It's kind of a joke. You own the equity, but you really are behind, you know, a wall of senior debt, maybe loans, preferred stocks. And so you're way down with your equity, and you've got a lot of debt out in front of you. So if you're not watching that debt and how it's trading, you have no business owning the equity. From a macro perspective, one of the things that's been very telling, like over the last 6 months, when the high yield bond market is wide open and triple C's are able to finance themselves, so you've got triple C rated companies, double B's, obviously single B's and triple A's. There aren't many triple A's left on the planet. But one of the things that's very important to track from a risk on, risk off point of view is new issuance in the high yield market and how easy it is for kind of the tertiary companies to sell bonds. And so if the triple C's market is performing well, so if it's tightening, and at the same time, if you're seeing a lot of new issuance in the lower parts of capital structures and companies that typically would struggle to finance themselves, that's typically a good risk on indicator. And I remember very clearly, like 2009-10, the high yield market was just so bid and triple C's were outperforming, and sure enough, the market ripped. And the same thing started happening last year through the summer and the fall. You really saw the compression between triple C's and say double B's, that compressed. When that's compressing at a very fast speed over say a couple of months, it's typically a very good risk on indicator. And when that starts to deteriorate, that means the capital markets are kind of closing down, and this is what's called financial conditions. So there's the Goldman Sachs financial conditions, there's this index, there's the St. Louis Fed financial conditions index. And the financial conditions index is just measure a number of things. We have our own bear traps financial conditions index. One of the things that we track more than anything is credit availability. And so when that starts to turn, that's typically a decent leading indicator for you don't want to be fully invested when it's turning. The perfect example of this is like 2018. The market was ripping. The Fed made a decision to tighten the balance sheet that year, and they were hiking rates through 16, through 17, 18, because the economy was raging. But they, at some point, they went from like $25 billion a month of balance sheet reduction to $50 billion a month, and the market just couldn't take it. And the first thing that started to happen is the credit markets in July, August of 2018 started to really underperform. In our 21 Lehman systemic risk indicators that we'd use at the bear trap support, when we see things like that, you just want to make sure it's okay to be invested. You just don't want to be fully invested. And lo and behold, sure enough, financial conditions tightened violently in October. And by December, we were essentially in recession, and Powell got us out by reversing policy. At that point, Goldman Sachs in the third, fourth quarter of 2018 was calling for 4 rate hikes the next year, and the Fed was also doing $50 billion a month of balance sheet reduction. I mean, think how crazy that is. And the Fed made Goldman Sachs it was probably the most embarrassing moment in the last 20 years for Goldman Sachs economic research, because they were calling for 3-4 rate hikes. That year in 2019, looking out in the third, fourth quarter of 18 over the next year, they were calling for, I think, 4 hikes, and the Fed ended up cutting rates in 2019-20. So it's those types of things where, watching the Fed and the Fed policy, and then looking at how the credit markets are reacting to the Fed. At some point, the credit markets typically will get way out in front of the Fed. So the Fed will be out there saying, okay, we're not going to hike rates for a year or two. But if the credit markets start tightening ahead of that, they're basically telling you that the Fed's not going to be successful at that kind of game. And that eventually credit will lead equities. And when credit starts to underperform in high yield and loans and things like that, that's when equities typically suffer. And over and over again, we've seen in many different cycles, credit will lead equities, whether it be with individual stocks or with indexes. It doesn't work all the time. It's not 100%, but a very high percentage of the time, when credit's underperforming your equities, your risk reward in the market when you're looking forward over 12 months is deteriorating. So your risk reward is going from good to very bad. And as an equity investor, it takes a lot of people years to see some of these things, and many people don't even look at credit markets. And so, unfortunately, what happens is they get left holding the bag in the end, because they're not taking down risk appropriately.